Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to cover the principles of the techniques I used to create this effect. But the main effect here is the material, the cloth that's being blown around in here. And if you look carefully, you should be able to see that it's not just a uniform wind blowing the cloth, but a wind that is affecting parts of it and not others. I've also got an interesting material effect on the cloth itself. So we'll cover both those techniques. So to begin with, let's make a simple cloth simulation. So I'll simply add a plane to begin with as somewhere for the cloth to sit. Give that a basic material and we'll call that ground. Let's just make that a yellowish material and we'll call the plane ground as well. Next we'll add another plane, which will be our initial cloth. I'm going to scale that down a little bit and just make sure you apply the scale. And we'll give this material, which we'll just call cloth for the time being, and we'll call the object cloth as well. So I'm going to raise it up, just GZ, and just put it about there so we can see what's going on with it. So now come over to the physics properties and just click cloth with our green cloth selected. Now if I press play, it just drops through the scene like that. So it's actually been given cloth properties, but obviously there is no collision with this object now, and that gives you the clue as to what I need to do with the floor object. So if I select that, still in the physics properties, and click collision, and now press play, you can see our cloth object falls down to there. And if I rotate that object and press play, it just stops like that. Now there's a reason that it's not really behaving like cloth at the moment, and that's because if I go into edit mode, you can see there are only three vertices, especially if I look at it in wireframe. So in edit mode, with all the vertices selected, right click and say subdivide, and we'll put the subdivisions up. If we said 10, that's getting there, but it's not really quite enough yet. So I'm going to go for 25. That's quite a few. And then come out of edit mode and now press play, and you can see it all crumples up. Not very naturally. If I rotate on the X to offset that tilt slightly, it's a bit more natural. And part of that is because we don't have self-collisions turned on. So there are a variety of different settings in here, and we'll go through on those in a moment, the settings that I use. But if we come under collisions, you can see there's an option for what's called self-collisions. So at the moment, the material passes through itself, and that's why it just forms this clump down here. We want it to realize that it is hitting itself and therefore not pass through, so we click this here. And now when we press play, it now recognizes that it can't simply pass through and behaves a bit more naturally. Now obviously at the moment we've got a relatively low resolution cloth simulation, and we also need to turn on shade smooth to make it look a bit better. Now the other thing we can do, if we come into here, by the way, the modifiers, you can see there's the cloth modifier. We can smooth it out by putting a subdivision surface on there, which we can do with control and a number. I'll do control 1. So that does a simple subdivision surface at level 1 on there. Now if I press play, now this doesn't change the simulation in this order. All it does is smooth out the results of the simulation. If I wanted to provide more vertices to the simulation, I can put this above the cloth sim. So that will actually slow the simulation down quite a bit, as you can see. And it's actually messed it up as well. We need to erase the cache and start again. So that's a quick way of adding more vertices, but you don't necessarily need to do that. You can see that's reasonably natural looking cloth. So we've got the subdivision surface to smooth it out. If I turn the visibility of that off, you can see it's a lot less smooth. I'm going to put some color into the viewport for these objects so that we can see what we're looking at better, but I'll leave that gray. So that's with the subdivision surface off, and here it is with it on. It doesn't slow the simulation significantly, but it just makes it look a lot better. The other thing we can do is add a solidify modifier to add some thickness to it. So that's just added some thickness to it, and you can see how that's working. And that helps because you usually do get some penetration of the object with itself, and that helps disguise that. So there's our basic material. It's continuing to slide around because we have no or very little friction on our collision object at the moment. So let's quickly just have the settings to be somewhere near the settings that I used for my scene. So if we go to physics properties, under the collision options for the main plane, I actually just use all of these default settings. And you can see here we've got a friction setting. So if you increase that, the material will be less likely to slide around on the surface the way it is right now. So it'll crumple up more easily. But that's up to you. Because it's a plane, you also need single-sided ticked in order for it to work properly. If you add this to a plane, it should automatically do that. But if it doesn't, you can make a point of clicking that there. So now if we look at our physics properties for our cloth, to begin with, there's the quality of the simulation and the speed multiplier. So if you want it to look like a realistic cloth material in, as it were, real time as opposed to slow motion, leave the speed multiplier on 1. If you want it to be sort of slow motion, you can reduce it to a smaller number, 0.5 or whatever. Quality steps is how accurate the simulation is. Higher number will give you a more accurate cloth simulation, but will take longer to simulate, which may or may not be a problem. Physical properties. This is the weight of the cloth. Is it a heavy cloth? Is it a light cloth? So I've got default properties here. I didn't change these. If you want a very light, like a tissue paper, obviously you can go to a smaller weight there. If you want a very heavy, dense cloth, you can increase that. Again, the basic stiffness settings will be fine for this effect, and you can play around with these to get the effects that you want, but their names give you an idea of what they do. You can see here bending, how much it resists bending. So you can play around with those. And then damping, obviously tension, compression, shear and bending. It will help to slow the material down if you want higher numbers for these. So again, the defaults are pretty fair for this effect, but it will allow you to have a material that flaps around more slowly, for example. I didn't use internal spring, so obviously this is for a material that has a springiness to it, and pressure we won't get into. Cache. This is one of the ones that hasn't been changed, so the default is still 250 frames, and you can see, because I ran it through, it's stored 250 frames into there. As normal, you can bake that. If you want to hold the material or pull it around by any of its vertices, you can create a group of vertices, which can be one or more vertices. Let's just select 3 here. Come over to vertex groups and click plus here and assign. So if I unselect those and then say select, we've got 3 vertices there that are part of this vertex group. Go back to the physics properties under pinning group, which is under the shape section. We can now select that group. And if I now click play, you can see the material is hanging by that pinned group. And that could be associated with another object, or it could just be moved around, as you can see. So that's just pinned that part of the material. But we don't want that for this simulation. We want it to just fall to the ground. As I said before, we want self-collisions on. Distance is about how close, in this case, 2 parts of the object need to get in order to trigger a collision. In other words, hopefully not pass through each other. And it's the same up here for object collision. So when this object gets within 0.015 meters of this object, a collision object, an assumption is made that they are in contact and they will behave as though they are colliding. And again, we've got friction here. Impulse clamping is an effect you use if you're getting some strange effects from bits of material flying off in strange directions. You can use it to sort of stabilize the simulation, but generally speaking, you don't need to. And under field weights, if you want to, you can set how much any particular force, including gravity, affects the material. So I could turn gravity to 0, and of course nothing happens because there's nothing pulling the material down now, or set it to 1/2, and it's still affected by gravity, but a lot less than it was, so you can see it behaves slightly differently. But we'll leave that at maximum for this effect. So we'll remove the rotation, Alt-R, on that object. Having removed the rotation, we'll just move it to just above the ground. We can see whether it's below the ground or not by just looking underneath. As long as it's all disappeared, we know it's basically on that surface. In fact, it needs to be slightly above it by the looks of things. And that's just due to the collision distance. But that's good enough. So what we'll do now is just duplicate that a few times. I'm just using Shift D. I haven't lined those up perfectly, but it doesn't matter too much. So there we have a bunch of materials. And you can see it's taking quite a bit longer now to simulate it. Although you can just bake it and it's all done. But obviously there's nothing disturbing that material at the moment. It's basically just lying on that collision object. So the next thing I'm going to do is add a force field, which is a wind. Doesn't strictly matter where it is in the scene, but it's always handy to have it somewhere that sort of makes sense to you. I'm going to delete some of these because the simulation is going quite slowly and I just want it to be quick enough that I can demonstrate these effects to you. So you can see when I'm simulating, there is actually a wind blowing, but it's not strong enough currently to affect these cloth squares. So nothing's happening. So with the wind force selected, we'll go to the physics settings and I have a very strong force. Let's try this at 5,000. And if we just restart the simulation there, you can see we're now starting to blow our materials up. Look like little cushions for a minute there. And then they're starting to fall off the wind, as it were, and flap around. Next, I'm going to add flow. This sort of connect any vortices in the wind to make them flow around like a real gust of wind does, rather than just be completely random movements. So we'll put about 8 on that. And then we'll add some noise. I put about 8 for the noise. So again, this adds some randomness to the wind, and the seed doesn't matter too much, but just put a random number on there. We do need to turn on absorption because we want certain collision objects to be able to get in the way of this wind. We don't want this one to, and the reason it won't is because field absorption is set to 0. You'll see why we need this in a moment. So I'm going to turn absorption on. We don't need fall off. Press play again. You see that hasn't really changed anything. We've still got our wind puffing these things up a bit like parachutes. And then down they fall and they'll carry on being blown around. So what we want now is something to sort of get in the way of that. So I'm going to add another object. We'll use a cube this time. We'll scale it on the Z. There's no particular reason it needs to be a cube, but that was what I decided to do. And I'm just going to put it about there, and then I'm going to put it beneath that plane. And I'm just going to leave it there for a moment. But I'm going to turn on collision, and this time I'm going to say field absorption is maximum at 1. So if I press play now, you can see cloth that is just above that object is not being affected by the wind. And if I move it, you can see they are now affected. You're probably beginning to guess how we're going to do this effect now. So I'll make that a little bit smaller. I'm just looking from below, and I'll just randomly place several of them around. We won't have one quite in the middle, I think. I'm going to add a curve which is a circle. And just for tidiness, I'll put it about the same level as these objects. Doesn't matter that they're not all precisely lined up there. Open up this little arrow here with that circle selected. Go to the beginning of my animation and press I over rotation. Go to the end of my animation and under Z, let's put 720 and press I there. I'm going to open up a new window and go to the graph editor under key, still with that circle selected, under interpolation and say linear. So that's so it doesn't speed up slowly and then slow down. It just has a constant speed. So we've got that little circle rotating now. You can see the cloth going a bit strange right now. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to parent all these objects to this object. So Control P and just say object. So now when that one is moved around, they all move together. I'm now going to parent that object to the circle. So when I press play now, you can see they all move around. And already that's obviously having a certain effect on the material above it. I'm going to just remove the solidify and subdivision surface modifiers just to make Blender's life a little easier while I'm demonstrating this effect. And then what we can do just to make things slightly more interesting again, I'm going to go to the beginning of the animation, and with this main object selected, I'm going to press I and select location. Now in the graph editor up here, if I say select the X location, open up this little side option here and go to modifiers, add a modifier and say built-in function. And you can see we've already got a sine wave on there. So if I press play now, you can see that's shooting backwards and forwards. So we don't want it to be quite that extreme. So if we set the amplitude to 0.25, phase multiplier to 0.2, that should have slowed it down a little bit, but it still gives us a little bit of a wobble on these positions. Maybe we'll go to 0.5 just to add a little bit more randomness to the movement. So they're just shuffling around as well as going around in a circle, maybe even slightly bigger than that, maybe slightly faster. So I'm going to set this just to 100 frames, and I'm going to just put another set cloth squares on there. And then I'll select one, go to the physics properties, set that to 100 frames as well, and then just say bake all dynamics. And you can see how many frames it's done there. So here we are. I changed a few settings once I'd baked it and I could see how things were going. I have the speed of rotation of my circle, and I reduced the phase multiplier for the wobble 2.1, so that slowed that down a little bit. But overall, that's now seems to be working quite well. You can see how they're not just all blowing up in the air in one go. We've got some that don't go straight up. We've got others that go up a little and then fall back down again. And that's all because of the effect of these objects absorbing some of the wind, getting in the way of it, basically. So that's it for the cloth simulation. And I'll just show you how I did the material, which is a little unusual. So before I do that, let's just add a few lights. We'll just add a few point lights and we'll make them quite bright. And I'll just put a few of them around. So we'll go into rendered view and there is our scene. This is in cycles, of course. Nothing to say you couldn't do this in EV pretty much as well. And I'll change this upper screen to the shader editor. So it's not as fancy as it seems, but there's a few clever little tricks in here. So first of all, I'm just going to add an input, which is a texture coordinate input. And I'm also going to add a texture, which is the Voronoi texture. And I'm going to use the generated texture coordinate for that. I used Smooth F1. I had a scale of 15, and the other two options were left at default. I then added, under vector, a bump node. I took the position output from my Voronoi texture and put that into height, and took the normal output, put that into the normal on the principal shader. And you can see we've got this sort of bumpiness to it now. And I set the strength to about 0.5. And if you want to, you can change the scale. I can increase that a little bit to get a few more bumps on each cloth. Perhaps increase the strength a little bit for this one as well. So that's the sort of crinkly effect. And now for the sort of glittery effect. To do that, I added an input, which is a layer weight. I took the normal output from the texture coordinate, put that into the normal on the layer weight. I then added, under converters, a color ramp. Drop that there. I added quite a few additional nodes. I'll just put a few. And for each one, I put a different color. So let's set this one a nice bright green, this one to yellow, then red, then blue, and I'll set this one to blue as well. And if you want to, in fact, I think I'm going to set this one to red as well. And then that allows you to have more of the surface dedicated to that particular color if you want to. I'm then going to take the color output there and put that into base color, and the facing output from the layer weight and put that into the factor input on the color ramp. Immediately you can see we're getting some interesting effects. I set metallic up at about 0.65. So it just gives you that metallic look. And I put roughness down to about 0.2. Now we've got some shininess to it. And that was pretty much all I changed there. And then it's just a matter of selecting the method of blending that you want to use and play around with these options to get you the amount of color of a particular color that you would like. And you can see the colors seem to move depending on what angle you're looking at it at, which is what this layer weight does for us. And that's really all there is to it. Just added a bit more light into the scene. So I hope you enjoyed that tutorial. If you did, let me know, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.